Students, today we will be discussing about the urban-rural divide. Now, what exactly does this term mean, urban-rural divide? As you know that the government is successfully conducting so many different programs for the urban sector as well as for the rural sector. But at the same time, there is so much of a gap between what has finally emerged for the urban sector and for the rural sector. And today we are going to be discussing that the divide that is there between the urban and the rural. And in we will be discussing this in the context of education, infrastructure, medical, healthcare, as well as income levels and a host of other parameters on the basis of which we will be discussing the urban-rural divide. So the urban-rural divide exists in India after decades of planned development. And as you know, planning itself was conceived as an instrument to narrow down these kind of disparities. Yet it has not happened despite 6 decades of independence. India's development has benefited only a small percentage of population as it has concentrated on the growth of the economy, not on equity and equality. This has widened the gap between the urban and the rural, widened the gap between the haves and the have-nots. And therefore, India actually needs socio-economic development and just not only economic development. Now we will be discussing in detail about what is our concept of rural India, and then how each of these parameters are different for the urban sector and for the rural sector. Now, rural India is actually like a pyramid. The top of the pyramid is occupied by the rich farmers and the businessmen. They constitute only 5% of the rural population. And the next level is belonging to those people who have a regular source of income. And the base of the pyramid is composed of the landless laborers and people who have not a regular source of income. And they are mostly daily wage laborers. So even within the country, there is a wide disparity between the different states. There are some states which are very well developed and their rural poor people also fare better than their other counterparts in other states. We find that in states like Punjab, Haryana, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh and Kerala and also parts of Maharashtra, we have much more developed rural India. But the rest of the states are very undeveloped, where power, infrastructure are actually very big problems. And they also lack a lot of other basic facilities. What is the urban-rural divide? The rural-urban contrast in India is one of the most glaring examples, because 70% of the population resides in the rural areas. And agriculture is the main occupation for most of them. They contribute about 25% to the GDP, and yet at the same time, what they get in turn is only 5% of the allocated funds. So this is in itself an inequality, because they are contributing more than what they are getting back in return. There are inequalities in income, lack of non-farm employment opportunities, lack of infrastructure and civic amenities, inadequate access to education, healthcare and other basic services are some of the major areas where rural areas lag behind. However, the divide between the urban and rural India is thinning among the top segment of rural India, because the richer people in the rural India are almost like their urban counterparts. There's not so much of a difference between the rich rural people and the rich urban people. They are almost at par with each other. It's the other strata of the society where the divide is much more apparent. Now, let us have some examples of the disparities of the urban and rural India, we find that people in rural areas are still living in houses made of mud, barring houses of very rich and progressive farmers. Road connectivity in rural India has improved, but roads are of poor quality and without drainage support. Electricity supply is very low for villages even after 6 decades of independence, and still there are many villages which have not even been electrified. Mobile connections, as you know, in the urban areas are very, very common, although they also exist in the rural areas, but they are very few in number, while the penetration for mobile telephony is very high in urban areas. In rural areas, it more exists as a means of communication. Maybe one person may be having it, he might actually be letting others use his mobile phone in return for a certain amount of payment. So that kind of telephone connectivity exists in the rural areas, but it is not as widespread as it is in the urban areas. Regarding water and sanitation, again the divide is quite apparent. It is a challenge both in the urban and the rural areas, but more so in the rural areas. And we find that only 1 in 3 Indians have access to sanitation facilities. In the urban areas, 70% of the population would be getting piped water, but the same for rural areas is only 18.7%. Public health facilities are also inadequate in rural areas, and the death rate is 9.6% per thousand, while the same figure for the urban areas is 6%. In rural areas, the infant mortality rate is 77 per 1,000, while in the urban areas, it is 45. So these are some of the examples of how the rural people fare much worse than their urban counterparts, even though they live in the same country and the development for everyone has to be equal. Yet at the same time, although our country is progressing and the whole world is looking up to India as one of the fastest growing economies in the world, yet at the same time, in our own country, the divide between the rural and the urban is rather glaring in so many different aspects. I would like to tell you about what Dr. Kalam, our president, earlier president, he had to say on the urban-rural divide. In 2008, Dr. Kalam said he dreamt that by 2020, India would be a nation, and I quote, where the rural and urban divide has reduced to a thin line and there is an equitable distribution and adequate access to energy and quality water. So these are some of the thoughts which were expounded by our president when he demitted office in 2007. Our present Home Minister and earlier Finance Minister, Dr. Chidambaram, what he had to say about urban-rural divide was, and I quote, despite a marked reduction in poverty, about 26% of the population of India lives in extreme poverty. A large proportion of the population is affected because of the inadequacy or absence of many public goods and services such as clean drinking water, sanitation, schools, basic health care, electricity, and roads. This was part of the speech which Chidambaram had delivered at Peterson Institute for International Economics in Washington in 2007. So despite the fact that notable luminaries have been very cognizant of the fact that there is a very wide rural-urban divide, yet at the same time, it continues to exist, and it has, for many years to come, it would still likely to be there, even though Dr. Kalam visualizes that by 2020, the divide would be just reduced to a thin line. Let us see if that happens. Regarding sanitation, it is held that toilet or lack of it is an indicator of the country's health. Rural sanitation in India has doubled from a low of only 22% in 2001 to 44% at present. The total sanitation campaign launched by Government of India has stretched to the last of the 597 districts to turn the rural landscape free from squatting. The subsidy-driven toilet construction program has helped to provide sanitary facilities in rural India. Yet at the same time, it is much lower than what is expected and what is desirable. The government has also launched a prize for clean villages called Nirmal Gram Puraskar. And this is given to villages which has got a flush in every household and the schools. Now we also have to understand that though a facility may have been provided, yet is it also used? So we have to also understand that this has to be looked at more in the social context in which the infrastructure has been provided. And it is found that in many villages, what happens is that though the sanitation facilities have been provided, yet they still remain unused. And the reasons may be many. One of the reasons why they are not used properly is because the subsidy, which ranges from rupees 900 to 1500, it warrants an equal contribution from the user also. In many cases, they are not able to make that contribution. So the toilets remain unfinished. And that is one of the reasons why they are not used. Secondly, the toilets are not adapted to use for women. And they are the people who use it much more than men do. And yet it has not been adapted. The design has not been adapted for use by women. Thirdly, although so many toilets have been constructed, people still continue to defecate in the open. And this is because of an age-old habits. Habits are very difficult to change. So when the planners, they were deciding to provide more and more infrastructure, they did not take this into account that it is not easy to change habits for people. And the transformation of the behavior has not happened. So the government has to also not only construct the toilets, but also has to bring about a behavioral change. And for that, more and more awareness has to be created about the dangers of open squatting and for the kind of diseases that can spread due to unsanitary conditions. Regarding healthcare, as you know that healthcare in India is the responsibility of the states, and the constitution has charged every state with raising of the level of nutrition and the standard of living of its people and the improvement of public health as one of its primary duties. The National Health Policy was endorsed by the Parliament of India in 1983 and updated in 2002. The National Policy, Health Policy 2002, aims to increase usage of public health facilities from less than 20% to more than 75% by 2010. We are already in 2010. Let us find out whether this has actually happened or not. There are some figures which I will share with you regarding the public health expenditure ratios in India. And this has been worked out over a number of years. We find that the health expenditure as a percentage of total government expenditure was 3.29 in 1980-81, and in 1985-86 it stayed the same. It reduced to 3.11 in 1991-92 and further reduced to 2.63 in 94-95. So on one hand, the population of India is increasing, and on the other hand, the government spending on healthcare is reducing, which is itself a paradox. Then we find the other ratios regarding expenditure on Medicare as percentage of total health expenditure. We find that has also reduced over the earlier stated years. Similarly, the expenditure on disease programs as percentage of total health program has also reduced. So the expenditure which should have actually increased has been reducing over the years. So is it a wonder that we are not able to provide good medical care to the rural people, even for that matter to the urban people as well? Because the amount of expenditure that is required, that is desirable in order to provide good medical facilities both to the urban and the rural people is just not there. The government does not have the resources to spend as is required in relation to the demands of the increasing population. Now let us try to find out what has been the performance in the healthcare sector. And what we find is that there are vast disparities in people's health, even among the different states across the country. And this is largely attributed to the resources allocated by the state governments, where some states have been more successful than others. So what it indicates is that when the will, political will is there to make a difference in people's life, then they are able to do so. And that is only possible when the government is also providing full support to a certain program. So that just means that better efforts are needed by the local governments to ensure that the health services provided are actually reaching the poor in the worst affected areas. Let's look at some of the healthcare statistics. And what you find is that though 72% of our population lives in the villages, the government spending on healthcare is a mere 0.9% of the GDP. This is as per the 2006 data. While the World Health Organization has recommended a figure of 5%. So you can see that itself is woefully inadequate. Whatever government spending is there is woefully inadequate compared to what we actually are required to do. And even out of this 0.9% of the percentage of the GDP, very little actually reaches the rural poor. We find that India has about 5.97 lakh physicians and 7.9 lakh, India has about 5.97 physicians and 7.9 nurses per 10,000 population, while the global norm is 22.5. Of these, 75% of the medical specialists live and work in the urban areas. There is a huge shortfall of medical personnel in rural areas. So is it any wonder that the rural people are not able to get quality medical care? Because the people are not there to provide it to them. The government spending is not enough. What the government is spending is a mere fraction of what is desirable. And even then, the doctors are not available in the rural areas, the nurses don't want to go and work there. So obviously they are not able to get the quality medical care which they require. Some of the other statistics that I would like to share with you. The data which has been collected by the sample registration system shows that while the life expectancy in rural areas is 58 years, in the case of urban areas, it is 64.9 years. However, one exception is Kerala, whose performance is really noteworthy. It is 71.8 years in rural and 79.8 years in urban areas. So in Kerala, the difference, the gap between the urban and the rural is not very significant. Similarly, we find that the number of hospital beds in rural areas is only about 0.9 per 1,000 patients. In the urban India, it is 2.2, while the world average is 3.96, and developed countries, it is 7.2. 66% of rural Indians do not have access to critical medical care. Infectious diseases dominate the morbidity pattern in rural areas. It is 40% in rural and 23.5% in the urban areas. Malnutrition is also one of the most dominant health-related problems in rural areas. So we find that on every parameter, the rural people fare much worse than their urban counterparts. Let's look at some more statistics regarding birth rate, death rate, infant mortality rate, maternal mortality rate. And what we find is that the population in the rural area is 716, while urban it is 286. This is regarding the reference year of 2000. The birth rate was 30 in rural area and the same parameter in urban area was 22.6. The reference year was 1995. Similarly, death rate for rural is 80, while urban it is 42. MMR is 438 per 1,000 live births, and what we find is that it is 378 in the urban areas. Stillbirth rate is 10.8 in rural and 5.3 in urban. So similarly, there are a lot of other statistics also which point out that the rural poor and the rural people are faring much worse on the healthcare need that they have compared to their urban counterparts. As per the government parameters on health infrastructure, there is supposed to be one sub-center for every 5,000 people. This is 3,000 for the hilly areas. One primary health center for every 30,000 people. And for the hilly areas, the same figure would be 20,000. And one community health center for every 1,20,000 people. And for the hilly areas, it should be for every 80,000 people. Now let us find out whether that actually happens or not. As you know that primary healthcare centers are the cornerstone of the rural healthcare system. Healthcare facilities are poor and inadequate in rural areas. Shortage of trained medical personnel, as most of them are reluctant to work in the rural areas. Moreover, what has happened is that the medical health services have been clubbed along with the family planning programs. So this causes a kind of a distrust in the local people because they have preference for large families. So they prefer not to also visit whatever little facility has been provided to them because they fear that this would curtail their family plan, their preference for large families. So these are some of the aspects which the planners have to take into account when they are making policies for the rural sector. Regarding the healthcare infrastructure, we find that regarding the primary healthcare centers, the existing are 22,842, while the required is 24,770. Similarly, subcenters and the community health centers all are woefully short of what is actually required. Similarly, regarding hospitals, While in the rural areas it's only 31%, in the urban it is more than double at 69%. The beds are only 20% in rural area, while it is 4 times in the urban areas. Dispensaries are about 40% in rural and 60% in urban. Doctors are only 25% in rural and 75% in the urban areas. So as you know that about 75% of the health infrastructure, medical manpower and other health resources are concentrated in the urban areas and only about 25% in the rural area, where more than 72% of the population lives. So what we find is that there is a very wide contrast between the urban and rural areas. In the urban areas, it's only about 27% of the population, yet they get 75% of the facilities. In the rural areas, we have 72% of the population and they get only 27% of the facilities. Although it should be the other way around, but yet that is the stark reality of India. Then another thing we find is that contagious, infectious and waterborne diseases such as diarrhea, amoebabiasis, typhoid, infectious hepatitis, worm infestations, they are the ones which cause the maximum morbidity in the rural areas. Also, non-communicable diseases like cancer, blindness, maternal illness, hypertension, diabetes, they are also on the rise in the rural areas. And yet, at the same time, we find that the medical care is very inadequate for them. There were 2 All India surveys, that is the NSSO 46th round and NCAR New Delhi surveys, which showed that medical treatment is the most important cause of rural indebtedness, next only dowry. So when a person in the rural area falls ill, he has no other option but to take money from the money lenders at very huge rate of interest. And that leads him into spiraling poverty because of the indebtedness that he owes to the money lender, and who would never let him come out of it unless and until he has given his land, he has given everything to the money lender. So it is that they are open to more of exploitation because of the inadequate healthcare services that are there in the rural sector. Regarding healthcare personnel, we have some figures. Very interestingly, we find that, and expectedly, we find that the male workers, what we find is that what was needed, what was planned, and what was in place are all 3 very different figures. What were needed were 1,48,303. What was planned was 1,37,331, and what is actually in place is only 71,053 people. So what you find is that it is half than what is actually needed and what was planned. Similarly, regarding let's say some other figure of pharmacists, we find 32,132 were needed, 25,885 were planned, and in place are only 21,180. So similarly, you find that across the spectrum, we find that the rural sector is always woefully short of the facilities, infrastructure, regarding the medical personnel, regarding doctors, nurses, midwives, everything. They are woefully short of what is required, and they are much less than what was even planned. And even among the ones who have been assigned rural duties, many of them, they do not join the work, or even if they do, they are not present when the facility is actually needed, when they are approached by the rural people for consultation. They are not even present there. And there is no mechanism to see that whether the rural people are actually getting access to this. What we find is that what is needed is 32,132. What is finally planned is 25,885. And what is in place is 21,118. So the actual in place is only a percentage, a small percentage of what is actually needed and what was planned. And even among that, what we find is that regarding the medical personnel, those who have been assigned rural duties, they either do not join their duties, or even if they do, they are not present when the rural people visit them. So, in effect, the rural facility regarding medical care is not practically available to the rural poor, because of which they are finally exploited by the private sector, because not only do they have to incur a considerable expenditure in getting medical help from the private sector, but also because they cannot afford it. So they are also forced to take loans. They become indebted to the money lenders, and many times they have to also lose their assets in terms of land. So it has a spiraling effect on the rural people. Yet at the same time, these are some of the aspects which are not taken care of when the policies are made and framed, and it also has to be implemented, because as it is, the plan is very short of what actually is required. Then in place is even less than what is needed. So we find that the rural poor it's a double-edged sword for them. They are getting the bad end of the stick for everything that they are doing. So it's for the planners to see that whatever is planned is at least available to the rural people. Other infrastructure problems, when we come to that, let us find what it is. NCAR study has indicated that about 20% of the rural households travel 10 kilometers or more for treatment. And as you know, in rural areas, transport is not easily available. So you can understand what kind of a problem it poses for them. Then there is the absence of doctor in most health facilities. The poor infrastructure of rural health centers makes it impossible to retain doctors in villages who feel that they would become professionally isolated and outdated if they are stationed in remote areas. And as you might be aware of, that the government has actually given a lot of incentives for the doctors to practice in the rural areas. And yet it is found that the doctors are willing to forego those incentives, but they still prefer to work only in the urban areas. Then also the other infrastructure problems that are faced by the rural people is non-availability of medicines, also lack of medical equipment. So in a sense, it means that there can be no lab tests that can be done. Practically, there is no medical facility that they can avail of. And so if they have a requirement for detailed medical treatment, then they have no other option but to travel to urban areas for treatment. Let's find out what is the private sector doing as far as medical healthcare is concerned. A study in Ahmednagar, Maharashtra found that 6 private providers for every 2,000 people exist in the urban areas, but there is only 1 for every 2,000 people in the rural areas, because the doctors prefer to go where the market is. A study in the urban and rural Nashik district in Maharashtra found that fairly inaccessible but prosperous villages had good dispensaries. The private sector is the major source of curative services both in the urban and the rural sector. So when the money is there, then of course it is possible to establish dispensaries, but at the same time it is difficult to find medical personnel to be stationed there and to be present when the villagers visit that health facility. Some interesting statistics regarding the private sector in healthcare, and what we find is that in 1994, there was a study that was conducted. It found that 54.6% of the inpatient rural healthcare and 56.9% of urban healthcare was in the private sector. In Andhra Pradesh, it is as high as 77.5%. In outpatient care, the private sector has grown in every state. All India, 81% of outpatient rural care was in the private sector. As much as 95.3% of outpatient care in rural Uttar Pradesh, which is a very poor state and has got some of the worst health indices, that was also in the private sector. So despite the fact that the poor cannot afford medical treatment, yet this, because they do not have an option, so they are forced to opt for private medical care. In 92-93, 57% of the institutional deliveries in India were in the public sector and 42% in the private sector. By 1998, the position had reversed and 49% of the deliveries were in the private sector and 48% in the public hospitals and 2.1% in the voluntary sector hospitals. So gradually more and more people are shifting towards the private sector. The shift was most dramatic in Andhra Pradesh. Let's find out why it is so. In 1992-93, private hospitals took in 58.3% of the deliveries and 41.7% were in public hospitals. By 1998-99, 70% of the deliveries were in private hospitals and just 25% in public hospitals. There is a reason for it, and that is because World Bank health sector reforms have taken place in Andhra Pradesh, which encourages a public-private partnership at the expense of the public sector. The project discourages upgrading the primary healthcare facilities if there is a private service in the vicinity. So the World Bank has basically shifted the usage of the public hospitals more towards the private sector. So it has basically shifted, and those hospitals have come up with one because of the World Bank support. So that is why the more and more shift you notice in the case of Andhra Pradesh. Health statistics in rural India are not at all healthy. As I have already discussed, that the sub-centers, the PHCs and the CHCs are much less than what is needed and what is required. In 1951, there was only one medical facility for a population of about 5 lakh. By 1981, it was one for every 11,914 people. By 2001, one center covered 6,087 citizens. However, even though the number of medical facilities, the infrastructure has increased, yet the quality healthcare is still a mirage for the rural India. And the growth in population has negated the impact of the increase in health infrastructure in rural areas. The reason is that no matter how much facilities are put up in the rural areas, they are still short of what is required. Regarding the rural health situation, we find that many families, especially rural ones, the girls and the women face nutritional discrimination within the family and are anemic and malnourished. Various studies have shown that in both urban and rural areas, people prefer to pay and seek services of private physicians rather than use free treatment at public health centers. As we have discussed earlier, most of the time the public health centers are not functioning to whatever capacity has been sanctioned for them, because the doctor is not present and the other medical people may also not be there. So people prefer to seek treatment in the private sector. Moreover, we also find that in rural India, and especially regarding the tribal people, they have their own beliefs regarding medicine, regarding their own health. So some of them, they prefer to use their traditional methods. Some of them want to be cured of through their magic and religious practices. And also many people in the rural areas prefer to follow Ayurveda, the alternative system of medicine like Ayurveda, Yunani, Siddha and naturopathy to maintain positive health and to prevent diseases. There are also some bright spots in this dismal scenario regarding rural healthcare, and that is e-health, that is, you know, making use of information and communication technology to connect with the rural poor, find out what the problem is, and then suggest them a remedy. So this has been done in Tripura, this has been done in Bidar, and a lot of other areas also is giving more and more credence to accessibility for the rural poor to quality medical care through e-health. And one of the very known names in this field has been Dr. Devi Shetty, who has been treating people from rural areas for their cardiac problems. And he has been awarded by the government also for this honorable service that he has rendered to the rural poor. And he is himself from that kind of a background. So he feels the pain of people who have had to do without medical care in the rural areas. So there are some bright spots, but still there is a long way to go. When we come to labor, as you know, labor would be skilled, semi-skilled, and unskilled. Let's find out what is the fine distinction between them. And what we find is that skilled people are trained or experienced in work that requires some kind of a skill. Semi-skilled are those who possess some skills, but not enough to do some specialized kind of a work. And unskilled labor is whose work requires no training or experience for its competent performance. As you know, from the people migrate from the rural areas to the urban areas in large numbers. And the rural to rural migration within the country is estimated at around 53.3 million. This was as per the 2001 census. Rural to urban migration was 20.5 million. Urban to rural migration was only 6.2 million. You can understand that people do not want to move from the urban to the rural areas. And urban to urban migration was 14.3 million. What are the trends in migration? As you know, India is an economy which is being lauded the world over for its very good quality, skilled people who have been migrating to foreign countries for in search of better prospects. And they have done very well also out there. So it is a very attractive destination for offshoring because of its very large and talented workforce. Academically and technically qualified experts have immigrated to the industrialized countries. But what about the unskilled and the semi-skilled? They also find opportunities abroad. So unskilled, semi-skilled and skilled laborers migrate to the Middle East countries for undertaking blue-collar jobs. The unskilled, semi-skilled and skilled rural labor migrate to urban areas in search of better employment opportunities. If the same was provided to them in their own area of habitation, then there would not be so much of migration because the employment opportunities are limited and in many cases almost non-existent. So they migrate to urban areas in search of a better life, and those for whom it is possible, they go abroad for better prospects. Urban labor. It comprises largely of skilled and semi-skilled labor. A large proportion of its skilled women may not be in the workforce due to family constraints. It's a challenge for corporate sector to retain their skilled workers, and that is one of the reasons why the salaries are constantly on the increase, because people find so many employment opportunities that if they are not paid higher wages, then they would leave. So that is why the salaries are constantly on the increase, because of the high demand for skilled labor, skilled workers. Regarding rural labor, it comprises primarily of unskilled and semi-skilled labor. Most of them are working in the agriculture sector, because that is the dominant activity in the rural sector. And that they, the rural labor, they suffer from seasonal and disguised employment. We will be discussing about what is disguised employment. That is, people would be seen to be working, and they would be engaged in some kind of activity. But let us say you remove them from that particular activity, and the work goes on, and you find that there is no change in the output. That means the marginal productivity of that worker was actually zero. So this is what is known as disguised employment. And employment opportunities in the non-farm sectors are limited, so they migrate to the urban areas in search of a better life. If they were provided employment opportunities in their own vicinity, then they would prefer to work there, but yet that has not happened. So normally they do migrate, those who can, they migrate to urban areas and even go abroad, for those who it's possible to go, do so, in search of a better life. Regarding social issues, as you know that India is a country where it's often said unity in diversity. It is a diverse country. It is part of our social fabric. Although regional diversifications are also there, yeah, and the traditions and customs followed in North India are very different than what is followed in the South of India. Yet there is unity in diversity. India has assimilated the cultures of invaders and visitors, and has created a unique culture of its own. All the major religions of the world find expression in India, where people of different faiths live together in amity and celebrate each other's festivals. So India is actually a secular nation where everybody is given equal opportunity to thrive, to live, and to live a good life. So regarding India's society and culture, we find that over the period of years, it has been undergoing a lot of changes. While urban India has become more cosmopolitan, rural India is also undergoing some changes. However, Indian society still retains many aspects of its traditional culture, which provides stability and continuity in a changing world. Let us find how it is so. In the urban areas, there is an increasing level of individualism and consumerism, because they are more exposed to globalization. But in the rural areas, the family and the panchayat is still the deciding factor for most issues. As you would also be knowing that increasingly the panchayat has taken lead in making decisions regarding family and marriage in many of the areas of Haryana. And what we find is that they have even sanctioned honor killings in the name of honor killings in the name of justice, and that has actually been carried out also. And people are not able to protest. Even the ones who are not in agreement, they also have to follow, because panchayat reigns supreme in the rural areas. However, at another level, we find that collectivism is also one of the social structure, because we find that, you know, people still like to celebrate festivals together. They still have a lot of respect for elders, and you know, there are some basics which are still adhered to by both the urban and the rural people. Single parenthood and divorce may be more easily acceptable in the urban areas, but in the rural areas, family is an integral part of the social fabric, and divorce would be a rarity in the rural areas. Regarding education, we find that in 2001, the urban literacy rate was 80.6%, but rural literacy rate was 59%. Thus, the difference in rural and urban areas in terms of percentage points was 20.85. The data released by Planning Commission show that among the illiterate people aged 60 years and above, 78% live in the rural areas. In urban areas, the corresponding figure is 48.2%. Of the illiterate people who are 15 years and above, but not beyond 60 years, rural areas have 55.8% and the urban areas 25.1%. So you can see the divide that exists among the illiterate population of the country. Most of them, they live in the rural areas. Whether it is the younger age group or whether it's the older age group, they all live in the, most of them, they live in the rural areas. Of the school-going children in the age group of 5 to 14 years, 82.4% live in the urban areas. The rural figure is 63.3%. Kerala has been able to bring this disparity down quite considerably. It is 93.2% in villages and 94.3% in urban areas. So we can say that it's only Kerala which has been able to bridge the rural and urban divide. That in the rest of the country, the figures are very glaringly different for urban and the rural areas. Regarding the education infrastructure divide, we find that primary education in India suffers in the area of infrastructure also. In rural India, 60% of the schools do not have electricity and 88% do not have a computer center. Government programs have focused on creation of infrastructure through civil works, and the situation has improved over the years, yet many schools in the rural areas still function without a roof, toilets or drinking water, which are the basic necessities for most schools in urban areas. And even among the different states, we find that there is a divide. Like for instance, Bihar, Assam, West Bengal and Uttar Pradesh are some of the states which especially lack in adequate infrastructure for schools. Regarding income levels, urban households earn about 85% more than the rural ones. They save nearly double that of the rural households. Yet at the same time, we also have to figure in that the cost of living in the urban areas is much higher than that in the rural areas. The reduction in income inequalities is a major concern in India's development plans. This has led to the compilation of income distribution statistics for policy making and for evaluation of poverty alleviation programs. The source of data for income are consumer expenditure surveys, national sample surveys, income surveys of NCAR and national account statistics of the Central Statistical Organization. Let us try to understand what are these different parameters. That is consumer expenditure survey, which is basically tabulating the monetary value of the various consumption items on, let us say, food, shelter, clothing and basic essentials, electricity, water, and this relates to the consumer expenditure of the households. The NCAR survey is actually profiling the consumers of various goods according to their income, occupation, location, and other characteristics. While on the other hand, the NAS estimates, that is the National Account Survey, is not only indicating the private consumption of the households, but also that of the non-government and the non-private institutions. So together, the urban and rural data for income is tabulated taking into account these three key parameters. What we find regarding the urban-rural income inequalities, the CES of 1993, that is the Consumer Expenditure Survey, shows that the rural areas, the bottom 30% of the population contributed about 14.25% of the total consumption expenditure in comparison to 51.7% by the top 30%. In the urban areas, the corresponding figures were 12.14% and 56%. This indicated that the poor and became poorer and the rich became richer more in the urban areas than in the rural areas. So in some way, the divide was lessening because in the rural areas, they did not fare that badly compared to that in the urban areas. The Consumer Expenditure Survey of 1987 had showed that in both urban and rural areas, the share of the bottom 30% of the population had declined, while the share of the top 30% had increased, which showed that the inequalities had also increased. So over a period of time from 1987-88 to 1993-94, gradually we find that the rural poor are faring better than their urban counterparts. Regarding the income levels, that is the rural versus urban, what we find is that in the rural households, the quintile, that is the lowest quintile, is the share of in the household is 18.1%, and their percentage share in income is 6.3%. While the topmost quintile, the percentage share in household is 21.8%, and their percentage share in income is 48.2%. So although they are less in number, yet their percentage share in the income is very high in proportion to their numbers. The similar pattern we find in urban areas also. That is, in urban areas, the percentage share of the population of the lowest quintile is 17.9%, and their per capita income is 5.4%. And while the highest quintile is the percentage share in household is 22.7% in the urban, and their per capita income is 48.7%. So we find that in the rural areas, the urban areas, the poor are getting poorer and the rich are becoming richer. So this is comparatively the same for both the urban as well as the rural areas. Although the proportion, if you analyze deeply, you find that it would be slightly worse off for the rural people. Other income statistics show that there are wide regional variations and urban and rural disparities in urban in per capita consumption. The per capita total consumption in urban areas is 63% greater than that of the rural areas, while the per capita food consumption expenditure in urban areas exceeds that of the rural areas by 41%. The per capita consumption is lowest among the agricultural laborers in rural areas and among the casual laborers in the urban areas. So it is the poor in both urban as well as the rural areas who have the worst situation. Whether it is the agricultural laborers in the rural area or whether it's the casual laborers in the urban area, they have the worst of the situation. And in all probability, it is possible that it is the agricultural laborers who have migrated to the urban areas in search of a better life, and this is what they are able to manage. In urban areas, they become casual laborers, and their fate is not much better than what it was in the villages. The per capita consumption is inversely related to the size of the household in both rural and urban areas and the extent of the land owned in the rural areas. That is, when the per capita, the income is the same, but when there are more number of people, then the per capita income would definitely be reduced because each the income would be divided among those many number of the family members. So that situation would be the same for both rural as well as for urban areas, and the extent of the land owned would also be determinant of the income that they can generate from that. A later study for the urban-rural divide showed that absolute levels of spending are dramatically skewed because urban households are far richer than their rural counterparts. At the margin, however, that's changing because between 2000 and 2005, real rural household consumption expenditure grew by 8% against only 4% in urban India. India's urban-rural income gap, that is the ratio between the mean urban and rural incomes, diminished to 2.8% in 2000 from 3.3% in the early 1990s. So over a period of time, the rural-urban divide is lessened as far as income is concerned. Then we come to another important aspect, that is the urban-rural interdependence. What does it mean? It means that it is the linkage across space, that is the movements of goods and services from the urban to the rural. It can be linkage across sectors, that is from agriculture to the service sector to the manufacturing sector. Or in other words, you can say that the rural activities, which are considered rural activities, let us say agriculture, taking place in the urban sector, and the urban activities, that is manufacturing and services, taking place in the rural sector. These are some of the aspects of rural-urban interdependence. Why is it important to have this kind of interdependence? And that is because we want to achieve balanced growth. Urban food and nutrition security depends upon the strong links between the urban and the rural areas, because most of the products, the agricultural products, they come from the rural areas, which are consumed by the urban population. It is also important to reduce vulnerability, and that is the low-income rural dwellers often rely on urban-based non-farm jobs and on remittances and other transfers from their migrant relatives. Those who have gone to the urban areas, they send money back home, and that is important for their relatives to survive in the villages. Low-income urban dwellers often rely on seasonal farm jobs and on the help of rural relatives in looking after children and family property. That is, when they have gone out to work, then they depend upon their relatives back home to look after their family, to look after their property. So this kind of interdependence is extremely important for both of them to flourish together. These linkages have a critical influence on natural resource use and management, because the resources, where they are plenty, they can be shifted to the urban areas, and where there is a shortage, they can be shifted to the other areas so that we can make the optimum use of resources. What has been the urban linkage, urban-rural linkage post-independence? We find that heavy industrialization has concentrated public resources in the urban sector, reinforcing the divide between the urban and the rural areas and widening the income gap between them. Farm prices were kept artificially low and agriculture exports were curtailed through quantitative restrictions and an overvalued exchange rate. So that meant that industrialization was promoted at the expense of the rural people. Labor productivity and income per capita in the rural areas lagged behind those in the urban areas, leading to an increased concentration of poverty among the rural population. Now, what has been the scenario post-industrialization? Let's try to find out the urban-rural linkages post-industrialization. And after industrialization happened, urban industries outsourced part of the production to the village enterprises. Because for one thing, it was more cost effective. Secondly, there were not so many restrictions on them as far as, you know, environmental considerations were concerned. So it was more possible for them and more productive for them to outsource their production to the rural areas. Urban industries also used labor and raw materials from the rural areas, which led to an increase in agricultural labor productivity and farmers' income. These activities encouraged the growth of small rural towns that served as bridges between the rural areas and urban areas. So basically what it led to was establishment of small towns, which was like a bridge between the urban area and the rural area. So they were neither totally urban nor were they totally rural. And that helped to establish and make those small towns flourish, because a lot of activity could be concentrated, which was prudent for both of the urban and the rural linkage to flourish productively. What would be the future of these urban-rural linkages? What we find that it's possible that, and it is already happening, that changes in land use around the urban centers would change from farmland to residential or for industrial use. Greater diversification of income sources in rural and urban areas, often involving people migrating or commuting between the countryside and urban centers. The development of small rural towns, which in turn will facilitate access to markets by both urban and rural consumers and producers, and would also lower the transportation cost. So the linkages that are formed between the urban and the rural sector, they would benefit both in terms of better resource utilization, in terms of more balanced growth, in terms of more productivity of labor, in terms of lower cost of production, in terms of, you know, a lot of other parameters in which both of them would be able to grow together as well as thrive together. When we come to rural communication, what we find is that there are, in rural India, there are basically two kinds of audiences. One is the rural rich, who are basically educated. They are upwardly mobile. They are more in tune with what's going in other parts of the country. They have got more exposure to mass media. And they also have the purchasing power, which is almost as that of their urban counterpart. On the other hand, there is another section which is illiterate. They are poor. And they are not that easily reached through the mass media. A rural consumer gets information on products and services through multiple sources of communication, but the decision making is still influenced by the community leaders. So the communication must address the specific problems, needs, aspirations, and hopes of the rural folk in that region, in order to be successful, in order to communicate their message to the rural population. Let's find out what happened. There was a study which was conducted. This was for two FMCG and two consumer durable products. So the study that was conducted both in the urban as well as in the rural areas regarding the communication. And the results were that the communication of the main message of all the four spots among the urban audience was almost 100%. But it was only about 30 to 60% in the rural areas. And what is the conclusion of that study was that the rural people are simple people. They do not understand very clever or, you know, suggestive kind of films. They don't understand that because they cannot relate to it. Then the use of unrelated symbols characters and icons confuses them. They want a very simple kind of a message, something which they can relate to and something which they can identify, so that, I mean, they can take a decision based on the communication that has been given to them. So the communication has to be addressed accordingly. There was one exception that happened, and that was regarding advertisement of Coca-Cola that was more meant for the rural audiences, yet it also clicked with the urban audiences. So what we find is that something made specifically with the rural audience in mind, it is possible that it can also click with the urban audience, but the same may not be true if something is made for the urban audience, may not click with the rural audience. So the communication has to be designed specifically for the target for whom it is intended. Now, we have discussed so many things regarding healthcare, we have discussed regarding sanitation, regarding education, regarding income and infrastructure. So many different issues have been discussed regarding the urban and rural divide. In most of the parameters, we find that the rural area is faring much worse than the urban areas. So what is the road ahead for them? We find that it is that all villages must be made sustainable with the necessities of life, namely food, clothes, shelter, education, health, security, and above all, opportunities to work. If the villages are sustainable, people will not migrate to urban areas in large numbers, because as you know, it also creates shortages in the urban areas, and the shortages are of air, of vehicular population, of shortage of drinking water, poverty, inequality, everything, you know, it worsens for the urban areas also. It does not get better for the rural areas, but at the same time for the urban areas it becomes worse, because everything, because the infrastructure is not so adequate in order to be able to support the migrating rural population also. So the solution is PURA, that is providing rural urban amenities in rural areas. It is time that the government took time-bound remedial measures for inclusive growth to bridge the urban-rural divide so that India can progress equitably. Thank you very much.